Welcome to the Rage Point, a video series going in depth on gaming topics. This episode has been empowered by music from White Bat Audio. Links to Carl Casey's Bandcamp and music can be found in the comment section below. Today's topic, cloud gaming. In part 2, we'll be taking an in-depth look at the ever-evolving landscape of game streaming. Before we move ahead and delve deeper into today's topic, I'd like to take the time to assure you that if you happen to give this video a like, it will support the channel immensely. If you enjoyed this video, feel free to smash that subscribe button and ring that bell icon so you can stay up to date on our latest videos, live streams, and even YouTube Shorts. With all of that said, let's dive straight into the video, shall we? Xbox Cloud Gaming. The punches by Microsoft wouldn't end there, however, as Microsoft made yet another power move on the video game market just before Google launched their cloud gaming service called Stadia. Phil Spencer and team, riding on the success of Xbox Game Pass, would publish their preview build of Microsoft xCloud in November of 2019, with beta invites being sent to a select few. This would be Xbox's answer to the cloud gaming landscape, with its initial public launch in September of 2020 for Android devices, along with the ability to install Game Pass games on Windows 10 operating systems. Hosting a fairly straightforward campaign for xCloud, it would be the Xbox Game Pass you know and love, but on the go, at least anywhere you had a stable internet connection. And that tidbit is going to matter near the end of the video, where we compared these services in depth. Anyone with Xbox Game Pass Ultimate could theoretically stream Xbox games to their smartphone and install the selected games to their Windows 10 computers, with the promise of iOS support in 2021. And yet, having reached 2021, the xCloud streaming service wouldn't debut on desktop computers as a web service just yet. As it stands, xCloud is currently operating at a resolution of 720p, and it's promising to support 1080p by the time it launches web streaming through their Game Pass app on Windows 10 PCs by summer 2021. It can't be stressed enough how the streaming services so far require you to have a certain application running on a certain set of operating systems, or in this case, just Windows 10. There you have it. The two major console manufacturers have established their own cloud gaming services to exist alongside their console hardware.
But wait, there's more!
Nvidia GeForce Now.
Unbeknownst to anyone, Nvidia had been cooking up a cloud-based game streaming service of their own, touting that its initial research commenced at around 2015. A beta for Nvidia's GeForce Now would see the light of day in January of 2017 on Windows and Mac operating systems. Nvidia's cloud gaming service would, much like the streaming services that came before it, promise the future of gaming with low latency access to your PC games library. Where GeForce Now sets itself apart, however, was the fact that it worked through a virtual desktop environment where you can call up your games on the pre-installed game launchers, starting with the support for Steam. Meaning users had to navigate a virtual computer to sign into their library on Steam and select the game they wanted to play, if said game was supported by GeForce Now. Later, with ample beta testing by cloud gaming enthusiasts, the service would also see an Android client come to existence by 2019. Whilst improvements were added in the form of better resolution stability for 1080p streams, the supported games library would also see the addition of Epic Games Launcher to GeForce Now. With the service finally releasing into public access in February of 2020, boasting an early adopter's fee of $5 a month for unlimited access to streaming your games, or the option to go for a free version that had a set limit time of 60 minutes, give or take. It may come as a surprise that yet another hardware manufacturer is going down the path of cloud gaming, but there are several reasons this is all making sense. With the global internet infrastructure improving at such a steady pace, expanding its higher bitrate connections to further reaches from data centers, it allows ISPs to provide highly populated areas with gigabit internet speeds. This in turn creates the perfect living conditions for such a new market to form, with these cloud gaming services built on the backbone of video streaming services that already exist. Also consider the fact that not everyone can afford a top-of-the-line gaming PC or video game consoles to go along with each gaming generation. It seems these companies would rather test the waters or make the shift to having a steady income from an aforementioned online service rather than a fluctuating hardware market. So it comes as no surprise that even Netflix is actually delving into cloud gaming. And even Walmart is doing it now, but we're not actually going to talk about that because I can't take that serious. Amazon Luna. Just when you thought we had covered the gaming giants, new ones that have not proven themselves on the gaming market pop up. I'll briefly discuss Amazon Luna, the youngest sibling of cloud gaming, before I move on to Google Stadia. Amazon Luna is the cloud gaming initiative conjured up by the Bezos Fund to carve out a market share of this new and upcoming way of gaming. Announced in September of 2020, Amazon promised their cloud-based gaming service would launch with 100 games. As of today, their service is in its infancy and it is only available in the United States through an invite system since October 2020. And it is with this regrettable fact that I'll have to inform you that I haven't had a chance to test Amazon Luna's services. Amazon, feel free to get in touch through my contact information on the channel for when the European servers are green lit. However, despite the fact that I haven't been able to test it in person, I've scoured the internet for early access hot takes and testimonials about Amazon Luna, and so I have gathered a summation of major differences that could set the service apart. For starters, where Amazon Luna differentiates itself from other cloud gaming services is its promise to deliver game streaming equivalent to movie or TV show streaming, meaning Amazon will present gamers with an array of games that are accessible day one through their monthly subscription service Luna Plus, with games rotating out over time. On top of that, Amazon promises to deliver flexible subscription models where players can attach an additional bundle to their existing Luna Plus subscription to experience newer games. This means you do not purchase your games outright, but rather experience a rental or pay-per-view equivalent boasting literal channels or networks. For certain publishers such as Ubisoft with Ubisoft Plus, Electronic Arts with EA Play, Bethesda, and so on. Now, this last bit could speak to you or totally put you off from a service like this. In a way, it follows the same path that PlayStation Now walks with the addition of bundles. I personally have a subscription to Netflix, and I watch only a fraction of what is on offer, meaning I could be paying $10 a month to Netflix just for one show I'd like to watch over and over again, Breaking Bad. And so I want you to ask yourself, wouldn't it be better off just purchasing that one TV show outright on a medium of my choosing, such as Blu-ray or DVD? Now that I got you thinking, let me inform you I'll be making an overarching comparison for all these services as the second last part of the video, comparing prices and service quality. Google Stadia. We finally arrived at the ugly duckling of the game streaming platforms. There are particular reasons why I'm referring to Stadia as the ugly duckling, mainly because it's misunderstood, was cast aside, and forgotten by the mainstream media, except for the fact when they want to call it dead every f***ing single time. But its true nature is yet to reveal itself, because to me, Stadia is something different entirely. To paint a clearer picture, however, we'll have to go back in time and account the events that unfolded prior to Stadia's launch. If I've been able to keep your attention for this long, first of all, thank you for being as passionate about cloud gaming as I am. Secondly, congratulations are in order, as you are much like me, analytically minded. And thirdly, hit that gosh darn like button and smash the hell out of that subscription button. Alright, you've reached the real tipping point of the video and are about to witness an enlightened take on what Google Stadia as a game streaming service is really trying to provide. Codename Yeti. It's February 2018. Gamers are holding their breath for blockbuster hits that are coming to traditional consoles and PCs alike over the entire year. CES 2018 has just wrapped up the month prior with lots of outlooks on consumer electronics. From there, rumors start spreading that Alphabet Inc.'s Google is working on a subscription-based video game streaming service. Google was supposedly in talks with video game developers on testing out their platform, which clearly sparked an interest in multiple game publishers, just like with Ubisoft's officials that have happen to frequent CES as they should. Project Stream. With Ubisoft's involvement to investigate Google's Project Yeti, it wasn't long before things started to ramp up. The need to showcase the technology became an important effort on Google's part, and soon Project Stream was born, with the sole motive of showing people that gaming without the need for expensive or dedicated hardware is very much possible. In tandem with Assassin's Creed Odyssey's launch, Google started distributing invites and opened up the ability to sign up for testing Project Stream through the Google Chrome browser, allowing users to start playing Assassin's Creed Odyssey on their streaming service from the 5th of October 2018 onwards. Free of charge and no contractual obligations, people were pleasantly surprised, and it looked like Google was getting the necessary feedback. Stadia's road to launch 2019. Picture this, it's January 2019 and you've had quite a crazy year for gaming in 2018 with blockbuster hits like Marvel's Spider-Man and God of War on PS4, equaled only by the massive games like Red Dead Redemption 2 and Monster Hunter World seeing multi-platform releases. Google, much like many other consumer electronics companies, is showing up at CES once again, but Project Stream is no show and nowhere to be found. The only tidbit that made it into the press was the fact that Project Stream was wrapping up after 6 months of elaborate testing through Chrome browsers with Ubisoft's AC Odyssey. Testing was a success and Google would be making a showing during the GDC of that year. Fast forward to the Game Developers Conference of 2019, where Google is remaining dead quiet only to wait for day two and send out mass invite on Tuesday, March 19th with a mysterious message. The entire email would be shrouded in mystery, especially by the GIF that was included, where an animation depicted a dark hallway leading up to the bright light at the end of the tunnel, much like what a sports player sees before setting foot on the field of a stadium. The entire keynote that Google aired live on the 19th of March 2019 was made available through YouTube for everyone to see. Key spokespersons showed up on stage to present to us the future of gaming. The tech was the main highlight of this keynote, with introductory talks about deep learning AI, data analysis in virtual testing environments for real-world applications such as Waymo does for traffic behavior. By the fifth minute into the keynote, it was already clear that Google had a different approach to the whole gaming platform idea, and efforts were being made to try and merge many technologies into one. Key point being that Google's worldwide data centers and networking infrastructure were the fundamental backbone of this new game streaming technology, allowing for high-fidelity graphics to be streamed over low-latency networks. Specs and future titles were presented by none other than Phil Harrison, the very same person who was part of Gaikai's advisory board, which later merged completely into Sony PlayStation Now's game streaming service. Do keep in mind that Mr. Harrison has been part of many video game companies and is considered a video game luminary in the industry who inspired and influenced many, most notable for his contributions to Sony Interactive Entertainment as a Sony executive, vice president at Microsoft's Interactive Entertainment business, from which he moved on to become part of Microsoft Game Studio in an effort to grow their European division. Suffice to say, the man knows a thing or two about the industry as a whole. With his presentation came the promise of low-latency Wi-Fi-enabled game control, unmatched computational power, and gaming at 4K with 60 frames per second. Also detailing how cheating is virtually impossible on Stadia native games, split-screen couch co-op making a return thanks to the power of the cloud in Stream Connect, and the ability for developers to incorporate cross-platform play, should they choose to do so. As a bonus, there were playable demos from Google's research team at the show floor. These were examples of multiplayer open worlds with destructible environments, and an integration of Stream Connect into game design where asynchronous co-op was possible. Showcasing of a fairy tale forest where a player was aided through a command center of sorts, or a dungeon master if you will, and a secondary companion character with eyes in the sky. The state share feature was shown where people could literally share a quick resume of their game over the internet and allow other players to pick up from where they left off for their own playthrough. Or the promise of crowd play, where people joining your game at the press of a web link straight from your game stream on YouTube, or the ability to aid you through chat with polls. Questions arose, and all of this was met with skepticism and criticism, even before the service was available. Who on earth has access to internet without a data cap for a service like this? What about input latency? Is there variable stream quality for mobile? How many games are really coming to Stadia at launch? We're all left unanswered, and it was a most jarring thought for players indeed, to imagine their precious games library being available only on the cloud. And in my humble opinion, this is where Google's first misstep happened. During the very keynote, important key details were missing. Things like pricing or even a release date were not disclosed. They should have come out with the guns loaded and not just showing its shiny possibilities. Just a couple of months later, however, in the month of May, through social media, Google would tweet out a follow-up event teasing a price reveal, game announcements, and the much-needed launch info. Again, with a set date and only the ever-so-dooming word, soon. If this wasn't a sign the service was launching in an undisclosed beta form, dressed up as a full-fledged release, I don't know what was. Only later, in early June of 2019, was it made clear that the follow-up event would be named Stadia Connect and take place on June 6th, touting how some news can't wait for E3. And this got plenty of people excited, rightfully so. The tech giant Google was set to make a mark on the games industry. The reason I've been chronicling Stadia's Twitter feed with its garnered follower numbers serves as a sign of the attention it got over time and where it got to after launch. Some members of the community have taken it upon themselves to actually chronicle it further after the release. It doesn't end there, however, because there are dedicated websites like stadiastats.gg who keep track of the player base and all their achievements and hours played on the platform, including the total amount of players that have chosen to leave their profile public on Stadia. Stadia Connect 2019. It was at the Stadia Connect event of 2019 that Stadia's following became divided. Here, it became clear that in order to play on Stadia day one, you'd need premier access. With this announcement, pre-orders were made available for Google's gaming platform in the form of its controller being bundled in with the Google Chromecast Ultra. For access, you'd be required to purchase a limited time available Founders Edition at a whopping price of $129, followed up by the widely available Premier Edition at the same price or your country's equivalent listed by the Google Store. The catch here was that the Founder Edition allowed you to have an exclusive gamer tag with no additional numbers behind it, much like what you see in something like Discord. This purchase would also include a 3-month subscription to Stadia Pro, which enabled features like 4K and HDR streaming support in addition to monthly games. Some, understandably so, were turned off by the idea that they had to purchase their way into cloud gaming, as this was at odds with its fundamentals of being available across all your screens. Someone forgot to communicate Stadia was also working with an invite system. Much like how the OnePlus smartphones found their footing in the market as their production line didn't allow for a mass release, Google didn't want to overload the Stadia servers day one. But you can bet your bottom dollar on the fact that this was Google's way of making sure the service didn't get overloaded on day one, causing all sorts of quality and usability issues. Google would later open up Stadia to the masses as early as April 2020. If anything, this was done very purposefully, and from the look of things now in hindsight, Google would rather see the service grow over time than to see it implode at launch. But this didn't keep mainstream media from trashing on Google Stadia's launch, with its seemingly forced exclusivity tied to a hardware bundle, so much so that even now, people are convinced they need to purchase a peripheral to get into Stadia, or the notion that they need a subscription to Stadia Pro to play their games on Stadia. And that's another thing that was met with the mixed reception at the very first Stadia Connect.
Stadia Pro.
Stadia Pro, on the surface, is comparable to how PlayStation Plus allows you to claim a couple of games each month and play them as long as your subscription is running. To which Xbox Live Gold responded with their own Games with Gold, which works a little differently because you can keep these Xbox games even if you stop your subscription to Gold. Let me be clear that Google Stadia Pro subscription is different in many ways than one and is not required to enjoy any of the games available on Stadia's game store. I can't put it in any other words than saying the scope of Stadia Pro is fundamentally different to its peers because it chooses to combine the best of both worlds. What are these worlds, I hear you asking? Well, listen closely because I think you might be positively surprised. Stadia Pro is actually much more like Xbox Game Pass combined with PlayStation Plus's claim system. Yes, you heard that right. Let me get into the meat of it. Stadia Pro was announced as a list of features and a set of monthly games. The features mainly consisted of the promise of 4K streaming support and the ability to enable high dynamic range imaging. Why I mention the promise of 4K is because this is a feature that uses upscaling if the game developer did not incorporate a native 4K output option into their game. Meaning some games might be running at 1080p natively and Google streaming service will upscale this in real time without a noticeable latency by the end user. HDR, let's just say, is HDR like you would see it anywhere else, allowing for darker and deeper colors. Given that the developer incorporates this correctly, and your screens allow for it, of course. Now, coming back to the games, this requires some detailed explaining. I'll tackle this in two short parts that you'll surely grasp instantly, rather than taking it on as a whole trying to explain it as one thing. Part 1. As stated before at its launch, Google detailed how a couple of games would be made available to Stadia Pro members to enjoy as long as they kept their Stadia Pro subscription. Much like, once again, PlayStation Plus's game offering on a monthly basis. Cool, so a couple of games each month, yours to play as long as your subscription is running. Great, we got that, thank you. Part 2. However, what wasn't detailed by Google is how this offering was not just a couple of games at a time each month, but rather a list of games rotating in and out, much like you see in Microsoft's Xbox Game Pass. I just think they didn't want to call it that and they didn't come up with a name. But the key difference being the fact you get to keep these games from this growing and rotating list. As long as your subscription is running, you can play any of the previously claimed games. Even if you cancelled your Stadia Pro or took a break and reactivated it later, you get back full access to your previously claimed games. Noting that how most of the games that get added over a monthly time period, they get to stay in the list over a couple of months at least. Perhaps with the exception of AAA titles like a Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order or any other game that would be up to that caliber. With Stadia's games library for purchasing growing each month, it allows for Stadia to present a larger and more varied list of games to make available as part of Pro. Let me warn you that this is no joke and you might amass a ginormous backlog of games, giving you trouble with your family, your friends, and all the peers that you have around you, because you're not gonna have enough time to play all these goddamn games! Thank you for watching part 2. Join us next time for part 3, where we'll be looking into what really happened to Stadia after its launch.